that some of you may have seen this piece before. It's a little more embellished than what it is when I first introduced it to Prana. The piece is now just about ready to start to make its journey. And I'll be talking about Ponamu, Greenstone of New Zealand, today. And this particular piece is being prepared now to make a journey in which it's going to be put in a special kite. And it's going to be a story with it. And it's going to be given to one person. And they will read the story and hold the stone, and they're going to hand it off. This is going to travel wherever it goes. One day it may come back. But this is a talisman. This represents the sacred waka of Iwai Ponamu, South Island. I've got some young friends out there. And I've got fun out here and extended family as well, which is lovely. So, hey, would you like to hand it around to the other children? And it's interesting looking at the recording of the history of our land and looking at observations which were made a long time ago. And this book was gifted to me many years ago by a Jamasan priest. And it's called Musings in Māori Land, published in 1890. And there's a particularly wonderful preface in here which I'd like to share with you. What was said 120 years ago still relevant today. This preface, and I'll let you think about this, was written by the former governor of New Zealand, George Grey, who was a man of great tolerance and a man who understood the problems within the land at the time he was governor. And he wrote this preface, and it's beautiful, so I want to share this with you. I have been asked to write a brief preface for this volume, and I willingly comply with the request, which imposes no difficult task upon me, for it is already recognised by many in New Zealand and elsewhere that Mr. Bracken, the author, possesses that deep sympathy with his fellow men and with nature, which, united with purity of taste, imagination, and power of expression, goes so far to form the character of a true poet. Several of the pieces in this volume will undoubtedly be admitted to bear the impress of merit. Love the turn of phrase. The impress of merit. And those treating of the sublime and beautiful scenery of New Zealand are remarkable for their fidelity to nature. This alone is a merit of high order, but every country should have its distinctive character faithfully expressed in a literature which is a reflex of the land in which it had its birth. Such a national literature must, in each case, be greatly influenced by the nature of the country and the character of the Māori people with whom the early settlers came in contact. The more stubborn the conflict of races may have been, and the more trying the struggles undergone by the early settlers, the sterner and more earnest, even sometimes more melancholy, the character of the national literature is likely to become. It must be written. In the case of New Zealand, the scenery in which so many early disasters and heartbreaking wars were undergone was often weird-like and surpassingly grand, and at other times of unusual beauty and softness. The savage fierceness of the native was also frequently tempered with a knightly generosity, fidelity, and honourable bearing, which are not often surpassed. Thus, all the elements appear to be here combined, which may originate and mature a literature equally suited to rouse the people to the heights of heroism, or to soothe them down to the tranquil and blessing-producing joys of domestic life. The sphere of Mr. Bracken's labours may perhaps be thought by some to be circumscribed, to possess a high degree of interest, but it should be remembered that the early poets and writers of a new country give the first vivid descriptions of hitherto unrecorded varieties of scenery, of new trees, flowers, of the habits of the new birds and animals, of the appearance, beliefs, and legends of a newly discovered race of men. If then our early writers, with warm sympathies, and truth of language describe the sentiments and reveries that these fresh materials and their endless comparisons and combinations excite in the impassioned or meditative human mind, and especially the incidents which spring from the mingling of two such different races that must create a present and lasting interest for all who follow in the future. From the poetry of these first singers will also be culled out images and descriptions which will long endure as household sayings and apt similes amongst the new race whose artistic tastes they are helping climate and nature to create and maintain in this country. I thought that's so apt, the preface. It says so much of the man of the times and his observation and his feeling for the land. It also reinforces the fact that how important it is, not only with literature, with writing and poetry and prose, but also with every other creative person in this land, from the carvers of stone, the carvers of the wood, to the clay workers, poets, writers, sculptors, those who work in any medium at all, expressing aspects of the natural form of this country. It's something that we can take over and enjoy. This particular koanga here was gifted to me by a man called Kerry Strongman, who has a sculpture workshop up there. We're looking at a 3,500-year-old piece of swamp culture. An image he has created is incredibly evocative. We are familiar, perhaps, with some of the shapes here, but we are looking at something which is universal. He was inspired to carve this piece from a journey he made through northern Italy, and he was in an ancient chapel. And there was a tomb of a knight, and on top of the tomb was this rendering of the knight's sword. Isn't that interesting? So, once again, it's something which is transposed. It's a universal symbol. The sword is something which we all may wield at certain times of our lives, but whenever we have the opportunity, it's best to put the sword to one side and pick up the pen, or pick up the voice, or pick up the clay, or pick up the stone. As I take you through first one of the stages of a journey I made to write this book, you'll hear me referring to Konamu, Mata, which is the obsidian, and also the seed stone, the stone of remembrance. And these are fashioned by Mike O'Donnell, the clay worker, and the kaitiaki of the waters of Hauraki, who was here two nights ago with us. And Mike fashioned these stones for the journey I'm going to be telling you about shortly. And I've gifted 15 of these stones right out of the fire pit. The stones that he gifted to me to take on the journey were made from 5 different clays. And he gathered these 3 of the clays when he was in England and Ireland. So we've got clay from Ireland, clay from Wales, coastal clay from England, clay from Te Waipounamu, the South Island, and clay from his river of home in Pairoa, Karariki. So I'm going to let this do the rounds too. This is a seed stone. This is a stone of remembrance. It displays light and dark, positive, negative, male, female. And the emblems that he etches into these stones are once again symbols which are so common to us and which we feel so comfortable with. So the little kite is what I carry. This piece of Ponamu here, which I call the gateway, so do come and have a close look at it. It was gifted to me by Mick Collins of Waipaha, elder and carver, who lives in Rema. And it's an intriguing piece. I just call it the vortex or the gateway. You're all going to receive little gifts today before you go. I might tell you that. So if you go early, you might miss out. So I've got you a chocolate. Works every time. So, I write this small piece with a view of opening a doorway to a proposition that you, the reader, will be able to embark on or enhance your spiritual journey. to provide for many people a pathway through the labyrinth of mystery that surrounds sacred sites. The dictionary tells us that sacred is worthy of or regarded with reverence, awe, or respect. For a place to be sacred, an event would have occurred of significance to an earlier people. Wisdom keepers say that any place can be sacred, and such places are available for all people to see. In the course of my travels throughout New Zealand and overseas, I have visited many spots identified as sacred. In many cases, sites of this nature have an ongoing role to play, helping people today achieve some degree of understanding of the past, whilst allowing them to make a connection with the natural order. It is very easy to become focused on events and places in our own backyard, but if you undertake to visit or read descriptions of sites in any part of the world, you'll find a lot of common factors. There should be no great mystery around sacred sites, as they are usually the surface manifestation of the powerful energies that ebb and flow below and above the planet. They are a place of focus and power, and in the past controlled by those who wish to impose their wishes on the people of the time. There is much in the way of modern myth surrounding certain sites that may be called sacred because of their special significance to an ancient people. In some cases, the true purpose of such places has been lost in antiquity and replaced with a more modern interpretation. In fact, many sites that serve merely as a place of connection with the natural order were given a more supernatural standard. This would have enabled the shaman or the priest a greater degree of control or power. But I like to sort of step right out to the brink here and say to people that this whole landscape in this country is a sacred landscape. Everywhere we walk. And the fact that we're all given the opportunity while a prana to walk bare feet on the earth is wonderful. And if we can do this once a week or once a month where we live, or even if we live in a high-rise apartment in the middle of the city, go down the road and bare feet. People might look at you, but anything goes in the city nowadays. This contact is so important. We insulate ourselves from certain energies and chi flows from the ground. But have any of you folk here ever made a visit to Castle Hill in the South Island? There have been a few people there, which is good. So I hope that this is familiar for you. But for those who haven't, I've got something exciting to share with you. And this is, incidentally, is from the new book. All right? Yeah, I just thought I'd show that. A little commercial. I'm not going to sing it, though. And I've titled Chapter 6, The School That Never Closes. As I sit to write this chapter and ponder on the shape and form of the words, a kaleidoscope of images and impressions come easily as I bring into focus much that I have experienced thus far on the journey with the three gifts. The pen trembles slightly in my hand, poised over the lined sheet of paper. What will my first words be? How can I possibly do justice with what little I truly know to write of the most important sacred site in New Zealand? The Kohanga at Castle Hill in the South Island is surely the most powerful place that I have ever had the privilege of visiting many times over the past 12 years. And every time I walk in the footsteps of all who have come before me, I come to a new level of understanding, a new level of knowing, a new level of remembering. Nestled on the eastern side of the Great Divide of the Southern Alps, this ancient marae sits within the sacred nest at the birthplace of the gods, tucked into the lower slopes of the place of the star walkers, the celestial navigators. This is powerful stuff, isn't it? It sends shivers up my back even when I read it. These names are not just mere fancy, but rather a true description of that which took place here in ancient times. I stopped writing at this point to go to my computer to call up the site on Google Earth. Well worth doing. As I zoomed in from the other side of the planet, I could not help but feel that this minute pinpoint on the surface of the world could at first impressions be very insignificant in the grand scheme of things. Much the same as our world appears to be within the limitless space that surrounds us. Then I descended from outer space, the outer space perspective, to dive down rapidly to the South Island of New Zealand, and there it was, Castle Hill on the Kohan, sitting within the nest, surrounded by high snow-capped peaks and steep terrain. The towering stone features are not easy to make out from this perspective, but the power and the energy surely arrive from this image to open one to possibilities and potential. I recall the time we had walked the ancient greenstone trail across the mountains on the west coast. We carried the stone, the ponamu, the greenstone, with us, walking the peace trail of ancient times. Our journey ended in the heart of this old Marae. And when one walks into this place, there is nothing insignificant in the magnificence that surrounds you. The everyday world, your cares, your frustrations, drop away from your shoulders as one instinctively opens to the energy that awaits you. I hope this doesn't sound like a travel brochure, but this is what it is.
Travel brochure will stay, okay.
You don't have to go to Bali or anywhere. We've got it here. This place is open to all who approach with an understanding of letting go, to be able to move into the moment, into the now. The visual aspects of towering limestone features and the soaring snow-capped peaks are replaced by an internal feeling of well-being and joy. Well-being and Ottawa. Legend tells us that this was the place of different schools of learning. Young people were brought here from many locations throughout the three islands. If one can open oneself to this place, you will find that you are listening and learning. Indeed, you may well become present-day pupils in the most ancient of wisdom schools. This activates the teacher within, which we all have. We often seek the teacher without, which still activates the teacher within. Remember that. For this ancient marae is the place remembered in the Song of Waikaha, the people of peace, the First Nation people of Aotearoa. The placing of the three gifts, the three stones of remembrance, peace and strength, was to be for me a natural progression of the schooling and learning that I had pursued on my regular visits to the Kohanga and the place of the Star Walkers. I've sat within the ancient classrooms and been allowed to open to the moment, to listen to the wind and the messages held within the stone, to watch and wonder the dance of the kia, as the mountain parrot is called, and as it seems to me, to walk in the snow and hold icicles to the sun, to view the mist maiden, to sit upon the outcrop of a rock that is the place where time began. There are no teachers here today in the physical sense, that every word that was spoken and every thought that was projected are securely locked into the stone above and the stone below. The voices that gave forth the laws of nature and harmony, the one true path to coexistence in this world, can still be heard. And the subsurface energy lines that converge at the marae carry information into and out from there to all parts of the land and indeed all parts of the planet. Upon the topmost ridge, above the marae, to be found the most powerful energy point in this land, revealed for all to go and visit and share and understand. Brought to light by Hamish and Bar Miller, renowned dowsers from the UK, during their first visit to the site in 2003. During March 2004, the following year, we travelled to a number of places in the North and South Islands that we'd visited the previous year. We wished to check the response and status of high energy sites that had first been measured in 2003. Hamish tells us that the energy or ley lines that flow through the earth will often intersect or manifest at a point of high energy. This effect can be measured and plotted by the dowsing techniques that Hamish has developed over the years. So it was with an air of anticipation that we went back to the earlier dowsing sites to plot any changes. Among the places we returned to were Te Ati Pole, Castle Hill, Arnapai Bay, Maunganui Bluff, and One Tree Hill in Auckland. Can't stress enough that people live in Auckland. Make it up to One Tree Hill for a sunrise sometime, and you might be amazed at what occurs there. There are similar places all over our land. You've just got to open your eyes and look for them and find them over there. I've sifted through my photographs for this book and found many that were taken during 2003-2004, around the time that we organised an Earth Wisdom Summit and the Journey of Fellowship of Aotearoa. So I want to further share a few things that took place on this journey with Hamish and Barmala, Barry Broughton and Kushla, and Caitlin and Sika, and all who participated during the magical month of March. Travelling with Hamish was an event of constant laughter and discovery. We learned that New Zealand is dotted with energy or power points that present a shape and energy response that is unique to this land. On a board somewhere with some pictures on, we'll bring it out later. There is a worldwide pattern of ley lines and power places at most intersections. As Hamish says, there is a spider's web of connections that cover the whole planet. And John Michel, in his book, View Over Atlantis, stated that this etheric web very much reflects the vital energy of the human form called chi. From these energies, there arises the matrix from which emerges the denser planes of existence. And just as a human body has chakras and acupuncture points, so does the planet have corresponding points. And it is at places like this that humankind can utilize the etheric energies. These are energies which are vital to all life on the planet. Hamish says that the energies are benign and beneficial. And further, they respond to recognition and acknowledgement. This is the piece of Ponamu still doing the rounds. Yeah. Can you bear to let it go? Perhaps I can tell you why. So I've prepared a copy of this for each and every one of you to take with you. I entitled it Greenstone Dreaming. We are well aware of Punaru, the greenstone of New Zealand, and may well have stones in our possession, or wear pieces carved or cut from the stone. It is soft and smooth of touch, sometimes displaying colour that will range from the lightest component to greens to a deep, almost black green. As a beach or river-worn pebble or a large boulder, our desire to touch or handle the stone is almost instinctive. The stone responds to the human touch and will soon warm to the hand. Most people find that they will caress and stroke the stone. The effect is very, very soothing. And if you know of the importance that is attached to the stone, no matter how big or small, you'll find your response is one of peace and ease. The wonder of this natural world has been greatly underestimated by most and denied by those who only seek to own the stone for the purpose of profit, as opposed to shaping the stone with the purpose of sharing the value of it. There are very few people in the land today that have walked the ancient trails, carried the stone, and are willing to share the true wonder and benefit. For millions of years, the earth nurtured the elements and minerals that were to come together in a unique mix to form the greenstone. Geologists put the arrival of New Zealand at about 135 million years. The birthing of this land was very important as two different ocean currents washed the shores. Tapu is the name given to the waters of the Pacific. And Noah to the oceans that cover the rest of the world. So here at Prana, we're right on the shores of the Tapu Ocean, which is amazing. And some of you may have visited Cape Reinga in the far north and see where the Tapu and Noah oceans meet. It's quite an incredible, not a conflict, but an amazing strong merging of two elements. The double sea held and covered this land before it rose above the tides. And the old stories tell of the birthplace of the gods and the place where time began. Both are to be found to this day deep within the waka of the South Island, Te Waikato. And in the heart of the waka, the greatest of stones marks the site of the creation and the battle of the gods. The kohanga within the nest, amidst the limestone up thrust to be found at Castle Hill. The islands that present the landscape of today are far different, were far different in ancient times. The land has undergone much in the way of change through volcanic and earthquake action. And from this tumult have born the islands and the land as we know it today. And deep within the earth, amid the incredible action of fire and movement, was born the sacred stone of peace. The Ponamu was perfectly distributed to ride within the waka of the South Island. There are many stories told around the discovery of the gemstone, the Ponamu of New Zealand. Some have a direct link to modern iwi. Other stories tell of earlier voyagers who came to this land with the purpose of finding Ponamu. Today, more than ever, Ponamu has a very important to play in promoting peace and understanding among all in the world. How many times have we heard that New Zealand has a future role to play as a peacemaker? Why do the indigenous people of the Americas hold the greenstone in great reverence? In an age where much has been said of the healing properties of crystals, this fruit of the earth, the greenstone, has always been there too, providing a focus for a greater plan that can only be enacted by the people of peace. We all have the propensity to be these people. It's not a demanding commitment, but one that may be taken as lightly or as intensely as you would. Ponamu was, to the first comers, a stone of great mana or power, and was fished from the rivers of the west coast to be shaped and formed into fine tools, ornaments and hand weapons. The stone has always provided the challenge to carvers, and the extraction, distribution and carving provided the wealth of poanga that have been handed down and revered for centuries. This small essay on Ponamu does not do justice to the depth of history and knowledge surrounding the stone and the journeys taken from the early centuries through to modern times. The stone is slowly being distributed throughout the world in an endeavour to create areas of peace and harmony. At the present rate of distribution, one will very soon see the result and effects of the teachings of the people of the Waitaha Nation and the story of Ponamu taken to the wider world. I find this so exciting. Years and years ago, I used to look in souvenir shops and see a lot of carved jade or Ponamu, nephrite jade. And I used to sort of shudder a bit and think of the mass production of this in a little factory somewhere. And then I changed my view on this. I thought, wow, so many people are coming into this land. I want to take a gift home for someone. I want to take a souvenir home for someone. They're drawn to the allure of the stone. And some people are drawn to gold. And they'll take a pendant or a pair of earrings home to gift to someone. So Ponamu is continuously travelling and doing what it does best around the world. I mean, you can carry this to great extremes. A number of years ago when Raywin and I visited a number of Pacific Islands on one of these cruise boat thingies, I took it upon myself that every 1,000 kilometres or so, I'd go to the side of the boat and drop a piece of Ponamu into the ocean. And I thought I'd just put a ring around the Pacific. And one day I just tossed it over. The big signs on the boat saying, don't throw anything over the side of the boat. So. And hope the captain's not walking past. And then suddenly an announcement came over the loudspeaker to sort of say that, there, not about me, thank God, but at the moment we're sailing over such and such and such a place, and the water below us is 3 miles deep. Could you imagine that? So this little stone had gone into the deeps. Yeah. And also as I travel around the islands, we met people. I mean, we were tourists, but Raywin and I went out of the way to meet local people and talk to them about the sacred sites. Sometimes you only have a couple of hours, but you talk. Then I reach in my pocket, and I happen to have a pendant there, which I'd gift.
And for some people, there was an understanding immediately of what it was without saying anything. And it was so wonderfully accepted. About 6 or 7 years ago, when Raymond and I are on a journey through Canada to gift Ponamu to the Chehalis Indian people out of Vancouver, I stopped. We stopped in Hawaii and we were on the Big Island and we were a place called the Black Sand Beaches. Once again, in a tour bus, doing the quick tour around the island. Got out to the beach to look at some petroglyphs, which I have an interest in, carved in the rocks. Then I thought I'd go and just sit on the beach for a moment. The bus was parked up there. And I went and sat right next to an older island man. An older Hawaiian. Yeah. So I sat beside him and we just looked out at the beach. Not a word was spoken. We were comfortable with each other. And I was watching a turtle in the rocks, scrambling over the rocks and into deep water. And then I looked at him and we spoke. And I said, "This must be a very special place." And he says, "It is." He said, "The sand we're sitting upon here is the very sand from which the whole of creation was formed." And he said, "I'll share something with you." And he pulled out a cord from around his neck, and bound in a little cradle in the cord was a piece of the stone of the island. It was a piece of basalt, probably. Beautifully, naturally etched. And he said, "See the stone here?" He said, "This was given to me at the time of my birth by my grandmother. And it was tiny, tiny, tiny." And he said, "As I've grown through my life in certain stages, the stone has also grown until it was quite large." And he said, "That's the wonder of the stone of this land." So I reached in my pocket, as one is wont to do, and pulled out a piece of ponamu. "Oh," I said, "I'd love to give this to you." He looked at it and said, "I know what this is." And so that was all that passed between us, no names in a sense. And I found out later he was one of the greatest kahuna on the island. And so when we sat beside each other, there was so much was not spoken, but there was an incredible interchange between us. He has since passed away, but it was just one of those wonderful moments. So things can happen, magic can happen around the stone. And to that point, while I'm carrying on talking to you, as well as a little bit of paper, I've got a little container here, little treasures. And I want to gift each and every one of you a piece of ponamu today. I want each and every one of you to raise two pieces of ponamu from this. One is my gift to you, and the other one is the second gift to you to gift to somebody else you know. Would you like to walk around with this little bowl? And would you like to go past every person and let them take two pieces of ponamu? You don't have to look at it, but put your hand in and just close your eyes and take out two pieces. Doesn't matter how big or how small the magic is. There's so much I could talk about, and I think it's best if you share with me now.
Yeah, I heard a few months ago that the greenstone shouldn't leave the land.
1800 years ago, when the Waitaha people came here, they knew of the stone when they arrived from the people that were already living in this land, the people that were called the Stone People. And so the stone was found initially in the Arahura River, in river boulders. The stone was lifted from the west coast, carried across the Peace Trail, the ancient greenstone trail across the Browning Pass, and down to the Kohanga. It rested at Browning Pass in the lake for a whole season. And the legends and stories have it that at all times there was a guardian living up in the snow all year round to guard the ponamu in the lake. The lake froze over in the winter. It was snow this deep. Food was taken to the lady, it was always a woman who was the guardian. And then once the ponamu had rested there for one whole season, when the kowhai flowers burst out on the other side, on the Canterbury side, that was a sign that the trails were open. So then from the side they would go, uplift the Ponamu and bring it back down towards the coast. Then the purpose of this was then to move it throughout the country. Some of it went from Castle Hill straight out to the coast, others went up the centre of the island or down north or south. Now in those days Ponamu was carried all around the Pacific. It was carried to Easter Island. Ponamu, miraculous enough, hundreds and hundreds of years ago has even travelled as far as England. So the stone has always travelled. The stone is such that it's like so many things in this land. What we see in the rivers and what we see in the shops is that much of this incredible source. Raywin and I have been up in the Southern Alps to places where the Ponamu was formed, as it was over millions of years, and it'll often just come in a big wide seam, which is in the revealed by the ancient glacial movement, and you can see there. And I've been told, and never seen this, but in some parts of the Alps down there, there is a clay-like substance at these altitudes in the same shape. And you put your finger in and pull it out, and that is the baby Ponamu. It is clay. It has not yet gone through the process of millions of years of compression and heat. So it's an ongoing cycle, which is fascinating.
Do you know about how the Tohunga use Ponamu and other stones with rongo or healing? The medicine men, the Māori medicine men, use stones and the healing practices.
This is a point which needs a lot more clarity. There are a lot of stories given about Ponamu and the uses to which it was put. I can't comment on what went on with the Tohunga in ancient times, because for many years in this land, the Tohunga were banished. There was a law passed in the early 1900s that was illegal to practice as a Tohunga. And a lot of Tohunga, there was a demise of the Tohunga. But a great number survived in various remote country areas. And then I think back in the 1980s and 90s, last century, they revoked that order and the Tohunga is allowed to practice again with traditional medicine. A lot of the medicine of the Tohunga in more ancient times was basic herbs, but mostly for external healing purposes. Because in ancient times, most internal illnesses or even bad fractures or burns was a supernatural event. It was something which was brought upon the person for other reasons. Not the fact they fell down and broke their leg, the fact that something made them do it. So there was virtually exorcisms performed. And so the so-called evil spirit had to be pulled out of the body with incantations, certain karakia, and smoke of certain plants to rid the person of the entity which has taken over. That's all I know about that. And of course we had the rongoronga, the medicine of the land in the form of plants. So, in modern times, today, I know a lot of Māori healers use Ponamu in the healing process. They'll use it often in conjunction with crystals, just to help the influence of the crystals, and they'll work on the chakras or on parts of the body. But one of the most intriguing things I've seen is with body work, are pieces of shaped Ponamu with beautiful smooth edges or sharp points, which are used to go over the body onto various places and help to cure ailments which are muscular or otherwise. So that is very much an external use. I know nothing about any ancient use with the Tohunga of Ponamu. So,
is there any connection between what we would know as Chinese jade and Ponamu?
Yeah, any connection of what we would know about Chinese jade. The connection is quite profound in the sense that the jade in New Zealand is known as nephrite, which is found in a number of places around the world. A couple of places in Australia, New Caledonia, and then in North America, places like that. The Chinese jade, which is what I call true jade, is quite different. The textures are different, possibly formed in the same way, and the colours are quite different when you see jade. We do get green jade. The white jade, of course, was the most highly valued by ancient Chinese. Now, as I said the other day, some of the first visitors to this land 4,500 years ago were the Heimudu people from southern China. And they left a map in the South Island so we can now know that they were there. Did they discover the jade within New Zealand? Were they looking for that? They travelled right up the Waitaki River into the mountains to view the source of the waters. I don't know if they were aware of Honolulu. That landing would not have allowed them to find the jade. If they landed in other places around the coast and the west coast, they would have. So, it is, some people like to tell the story and sort of ponder on the fact that the carving, the intricate mechanism of carving jade, carving Honamu with stone tools and rubbing stones and drilling holes with flint was very laborious and took a long, long time. And often an adze or something like this, it would take two to three generations to finish one piece. So they were using virtually Stone Age tools, Stone Age technology. There was no machinery. There were drills made, the drill points with the flint. Now some people believe that the actual carving, of the ability to carve and fashion the jade, was learnt from the Chinese. Now, the Heimudu people are now known to be the Proto-Polynesian people. These are the ancestors of everyone who lives in Polynesia. There's that influence. Now, historians say that it took 3,000 years for the Chinese to come up with the methods and the tools to carve the intricate jade carving. That's a long time to develop. Māori would appear to have achieved that in 100 years in New Zealand. I think perhaps the ancient technology was known here, which enabled them to learn and enabled them to work in their fighting.
What is the relationship between, why is it found in those parts of the world that it's found in? What is the relationship? Is there any relationship between those parts of the world?
In a sense. Okay, you mean a geological relationship?
Any sort of relationship.
All right. Let's look at it this way. This is going back millions of years. We'll start back there. There was a massive continent of which New Zealand was a part, called Gondwana Land. And we were tucked into the coast of Australia. South America was tucked into our other coast. And then we were all fitted into India. And Africa came around that way. There was just one massive continent. So you can imagine that as the planet was evolving from the molten lump that it was billions of years ago, that the action of heat, thermal pressures, and earth movement was grinding certain elements of stone and bringing them together, compressing them. Look how diamonds are created in volcanic vents. Look where you find gold. It's always around ancient volcanics. So a lot of these things were fashioned very much the same time. But then, over a long period of time, everything split up. Africa drifted off, India stayed much where it was, Asia came round, Australia separated finally, New Zealand whoop sideways, and South America was long gone. So in all those places you do find jade or nephrite. Slightly different composition to New Zealand. New Zealand, when you come and look at the stone later, you'll see what I call the felting. You'll see the layers in it. So this is one of the unique natures of the Ponamu found here, because of the grinding of the Southern Alps in the South Island of New Zealand. The granites and stones there were just grinding against each other for millions of years with the movements of the land and the movements of the plates. And not so much volcanism down there, but just earthquakes and movements.
I think it would be fair to say when you look at the Hopi legends and the connection with Waitaha that every place that experiences a stone of this nature or any nature has a healing energy, whether it's applied by a tohunga or just being around it. So every place on the planet has its own mysticism and stories and sacredness. And I fully appreciate being in this land, no doubt, but I get a little bit wary of this is the only place, because it's all, because in my understanding the whole Divine Mother's awake all over the place. So when you talk about Castle Hill, and I've been there, I grew up down around there, and what an amazing place, but when you say things like the birth of creation and the house of the gods, it's not the only one, right?
No, not at all. The reason I talk about those is to bring to people's notice that in the myths and legends of this land, there is a catanon of gods which are far greater than the ancient Greeks had. So it's amazing. The people of this land had a great thing of gods. And so they were talked about. And there was a god of the wind and a god of the sea and a god of every plant that there was, so which is interesting. So we had this structure there. Now, every race of people have their deities or have the elements of nature that they understand and revere. There's nothing unique here. The only reason I talk about it like this is to point out to people that, like all of us, you'll say, well, I'm off to Machu Picchu and I'm off to Easter Island and I'm going to travel all around England. I'm going to these amazing places and there's big standing stones, and look at my photography on Stonehenge, and they're all wonderful to go and see. And I say, God, okay, well first, why don't you see what we got here, or when you get back, come and check out what we got here, because you'll learn something while you're there. Now the features in our landscape are not trilithons, and stone upon stone, and stone circled. It's far more subtle. Stone was left in situ. The greatest example of that is Modotini, if you've been up on the top ridge at Castle Hill there. Modotini is a stone, a massive natural limestone outcrop, towering boulder. And in ancient times, the people scaffolded it and shaped the surface slightly so it is like a kumara standing on its end, a fat kumara. And that is Modotini, the kumara goddess. Just down from her, there's another statue, which is a statue to Rakai Hautu. It was a man who came from New Zealand, went from New Zealand to Easter Island and showed the Waitahara people how to get here. And there's a statue to him. Anapai, in Golden Bay, around by Totorunui. You go to Anapai Beach. See someone nodding their head there? The statue of the navigator. And have you ever seen anything like that? Which is incredible. Okay. So we do have some features where stone has been modified a long, long time ago, but now so, well worn by time and sea and wind and rain. And so other than that, most of the structures that were put in place for purposes of ritual or tohunga put in the landscape, poles put in to mark boundaries, were made from wood, because there was just so much timber in this land. And wood does not survive. So many of these things just have gone back into the earth over a period of time. But no, this place is special. But I would say because we're here, it makes it extra special. But on the wider scheme of things, it's no more special or does not have an even deeper meaning than anywhere else. It's all interpreted. That's what you feel.
I mean, the crew was ready and the paddles were dipped in the water. The navigator had set the course and the steersman was true and standing ready. But as the waka proceeded on its journey, little did we know, Papatuanuku had other plans. She had sent out a request to Tongaroa, the god of the sea, and said the land needs water. And the god of the sea understood, way in the northern oceans, north of New Zealand, the waters rose from the sea. Ranganui looked and said, I will help to form the clouds. and the clouds came towards Aotearoa. And the prana walker was sailing, and the people were sitting back and relaxing as the paddlers paddled and the steersman steered and the navigator saw the course was true. And when the clouds reached the Coromandel's, the rain descended. And suddenly, all the passengers in the walker found they were going to be very, very busy. So the walker filled with water, and the bailers were busy, and everyone was drenched and wet, and there was a little fear, and there was a little uncertainty. But the paddlers kept on paddling. The navigator was looking straight ahead, and the walker was being steered. And so the people came through. The rain stopped. They diminished. But the most wonderful thing about this is the fact that there was something else marvelous occurred. Not only did the walker and all the passengers and the crew make it through, a little wet, a little damp, but we all survived beautifully. Something miraculous occurred. In the morning after the big rain, at about 4 o'clock, the storyteller was walking through the village here, round by the cave. And to my surprise, there was a massive lake had formed in front of the cave. And as I stopped to look at this wonder, I heard a sound. The lake was full of frogs. And I thought, this is incredible. And then I realized what had happened. Papatuanuku, the Mother Earth, had sent out a call for the waters to fall on the land. And the frogs were really waiting for this water. They were waiting to complete their incredible cycle. And so, when the dawn broke and the waters were seen by all the children and everyone here, suddenly the new pool became alive with the sound of children and the croak of many, many frogs. And in this short period of time, a great number of eggs have been laid in that pond, and very soon the pond will be full of life. So another cycle is being completed. And sometimes we have to stop and think about this. We think about our own comfort or our own discomfort, but we pay little attention to what is going on in nature around us. So tonight, as you make your way back to where you're sleeping, listen to the frogs talking. They're singing a song of joy and pleasure. So once again, we're coming to the end of another prana, the end for this year. Not the end for this year, really, because 2012 is here, and at the end of 2012, the Prana Walker will be launched once again. So, it is with heartfelt thanks that everyone here involved in the whole operation and the sailing of the Walker, thank you so much for being here and joining in with us. Thank you for the perseverance and the wonder and the will and the spirit that you've all shown. So blessings and blessings to all and each one of you. And take prana with you in your heart for the rest of the year, because 2012 may be a little turbulent for some. But thank you so much. Kia ora.